You would open your copy of God's Word to Luke chapter 7, verses 11 through 17. Luke chapter 7. We're going to read verses 11 through 17. It says, "Soon afterward, Jesus went to a town called Nain, and his disciples and a large crowd went along with him. And as he approached the town gate, a dead person was being carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow. And a large crowd from the town was with her. When the Lord saw her, his heart went out to her, and he said, 'Don't cry.' Then he went up and touched the bier they were carrying him on, and the bearer stood still. And he said, 'Young man, I say to you, get up.' The dead man sat up and began to talk, and Jesus gave him back to his mother. They were all filled with awe and praised God. 'A great prophet has appeared among us,' they said. 'God has come to help his people.' This news about Jesus spread throughout Judea and the surrounding country." Father, we pray today that the words of my mouth and the meditation of each of our hearts would be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I've had a few of you over the course of this week, and even a couple of you this morning, say, are you sure this is what you want to preach on right now, Pastor? I know you say that out of genuine care for me. You are worried that I might not make it through a sermon like this without tears, but there are a lot of sermons that I don't make it through without tears, so that's okay. If you're a guest, you may not know what's happening in my life. That's understandable, but my mother is really suffering and really, if we're honest, dying from pancreatic cancer. It is not a prognosis that outside of a miracle of God will end in anything other than her death, and so understandably, many of you have pulled me aside this week and said, "Are you sure now's the moment you want to talk about this?" And all I can say is, if not now, when? Right? We've been preaching this series on God's grace for us. For us. And I don't know about you, it may not have done you any good at all, but it has been good for me to hear once again the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that we are loved by God, not because of anything we do, but because of this is who God is. God is loving. And in a season where I have experienced doubt and anger and frustration, and they have sometimes gotten the best of me, it is good to hear God's grace is for you. In times where I'm exhausted and the challenges of the day are beyond my ability. See, we sometimes say something that is not in the Bible. We say, God will never give you anything that you can't handle. Friends, that's not in the Bible. Truth is, God gives us plenty of things that we can't handle. He just doesn't give us anything he can't handle. Like, I'm actually not that great. My abilities are not that strong, but I serve a God whose power is made perfect in weakness. It's good to know when we are weak, his grace is for us. And even in this season, on a week where my mom looked at me during a particularly difficult day and said with the honesty that only the dying can sometimes have, "Dying is hard." And I could only say amen, that we need to hear once again, God's grace is for us. And if it's not for the dying, then who's it actually for? Because I don't know if you know this or not, but you are dying, right? That all of us, we don't know when, we don't know where, we don't know how, but we are on the road to our deaths. A few years ago, the satirical website The Onion put this headline up: "World death rate holds steady at 100%. We laugh at that heading, but what's really the joke's on us, right? Because that's not actually a satirical headline. It's a headline that is 100% true. In the article, it really gets that the satirical part is our approach or denial of death. It says the World Health Organization officials expressed disappointment Monday at the group's finding that despite the enormous efforts of doctors, rescue workers, and other medical professionals worldwide, the global death rate remains constant at 100%. This article plays on the fact that although we know in our minds that we are going to die, and if we're just honest, most days in the heart of our hearts, we don't really think it's going to happen to us. We sometimes blame this on just the fact of living in a modern world where we tend to push death really to the fringes of society. We hide dying people away in hospitals and in nursing homes, when the truth is this is just part and parcel of being human. 500 years ago, John Calvin wrote that if we see a dead body, we may philosophize briefly about the fleeting nature of life, but the moment we turn away from the sight, the thought of our own perpetuity that remains fixed in our minds. I know this. The very nature of my job means that I have a front row seat to the dying. In fact, at my very first church in Marlin, Texas, you know, the average age in that church was in the 80s, which meant I did a lot of funerals. In fact, that's how they finally accepted me. After about the second or third funeral, they saw this young 28-year-old, 26-year-old, maybe even a pastor, and when they finally discovered I wasn't going to mess up their funerals, they said, okay, this guy's all right, he can be our pastor. In Marlin, Texas, if you ever saw the movie Bernie, it's a lot like that. And I would have coffee, get this, at the funeral home several times a week. It's where some of the people just, I don't know why, they just would gather at the funeral home to drink coffee. I guess they just thought, you know, that's just going to make it easy when the time comes. And we would joke and we would laugh, and even though death in that sense was all around us, we still lived as if we had all the time in the world to live as we pleased. When we finally, however, come face to face with our own mortality, we are shocked. Recently read an article, I hope you'll look it up, by Timothy Keller, the great pastor out of New York City, who also has pancreatic cancer, and he wrote an article for the Atlantic magazine in which he talked about how his faith helps and sometimes doesn't help as he approaches his own death. And he also admitted, as a pastor, I mean, how many funerals has he done? And yet when it finally came time to hear the news, it was his turn. Shocking seems to just be too tame of a word. When we think of all this, really, one of the things that I've come to discover is that our revulsion at the idea of dying, that the very fact that we get angry about it, the very fact that it causes us to well up with protest deep in our souls, friends, hear me well, that is the first gift of grace, of God's grace to the dying. The very fact that you and I have this eternal kind of protest at death itself is a gift from God given to us to help remind us that death is an intruder in this life, that death was not a part of God's original plan, that death is here because of the sin and brokenness of the world, that God instead has set eternity in our hearts so that you and I desire almost more than anything else life. We desire life because God made us to be alive. I remember at that very first church, Marlin, Texas, I was visiting a man in the church. He was 92 years old. He was almost bedridden in a nursing home. He had been in the hospital. You know, I was fresh out of seminary. I walk in. We'd been taught in moments like that, it's sometimes good to ask the person what you want the pastor to pray for, because some people at that point are ready to go on. And so in all of that, I talked to the man. I said, well, what is it that you would like me to pray for? And he looked at me like I had lost my mind. He said, pray I get better, as if there was any other answer. And honestly, when I was young, I thought, well, doesn't he know he's 92? I mean, he might get better, but that's not a long-term solution here. But the longer I live, the more I realize that his desire to get better is just intimately connected to the fact that God made us to be alive. And when we are alive and experiencing the gifts of God, the gifts of family and friends, of good food, of beautiful fall days, that when we get life like that, it is a God-given desire for us to want more and more of life. And our grief and even anger over the prospect of death is really God's way of keeping that longing for eternity at work in our souls. In our story today, we're given a picture of a grieving community. Verse 12 tells us that Jesus approaches the town gate and a dead person was being carried out. You've seen pictures of this perhaps in other parts of the world, the Middle East, where they'll still carry the deceased through the streets in a funeral procession with people grieving. And the text points out how sad this particular occasion is. This is a young man. We aren't really told how old, but Jesus will call him a young man later on. And he is the only, his mom's only son. She's a widow. And in that day and age, all people, their kind of social security, their way they lived in their old age was to be cared for by their children. And here her only son is dead. So not only is there the grief of his death, but there is the grief that she is now hopeless in the world. We don't always understand kind of the context that just because there are a lot of people around doesn't actually mean those would be people who would help her. It was just what you did in that community to participate in a funeral like this, but very few would have felt any obligation to help care for this widow in this moment. And I don't know, the Bible doesn't give us any sort of report as to what she was thinking or what she might have said, but I can imagine as she is walking down the road with that funeral procession with her only son there, that deep in her soul came out a cry, a guttural cry, "This should not be." I can imagine it because I have been there with families when parents bury children, and something inside of us just, there's no rationalizing it. It is just a gut reaction that we find ourselves in those moments saying, "This should not be." And here's what I've come to believe as a pastor. That is one of the most faithful prayers that we can pray sometimes. When we are confronted with the results of sin and brokenness, when we are confronted with the pain and the hardship that exists in this world, that sometimes the only prayer we can get out of our mouths, it sounds a little angry, but it's a prayer of protest, a prayer of lament, which in the Bible, if we read the book of Psalms, it gives us permission to pray like that. Because here's something, when we say this should not be, we're actually agreeing with God. Because God doesn't want sin to be at work in the world. That God doesn't want death to be at work in the world. And that protest that erupts within us, it is a protest, I believe, from God's own heart. Because God is the one who set eternity in our souls. And that desire helps remind us that we were made for more than the brokenness of this life. C.S. Lewis put it this way years ago in his book, Mere Christianity. He talked about the fact that creatures are not born with a desire unless satisfaction for those desires exist. So he talks about a baby feels hunger. Well, there's such a thing as food. A duckling wants to swim. Well, there's such a thing as water. He goes on to say, if I find in myself a desire which no experience in this world can satisfy, the most probable explanation is that I was made for another world. In that he says, I must take care, on the one hand, never to despise or be unthankful for these earthly blessings, but on the other hand, I must never mistake them for the something else of which they are only a kind of copy or echo or mirage. I must keep alive in myself the desire for my true country, which I shall not find until after death. I must never let it get snowed under or turned aside. I must make it the main object of life to press on to that other country and to help others do the same. One of the challenges for us in our modern world is that we enjoy such plenty that it's sometimes easy for us to mistake this life for the life we were actually made for. I mean, we live in beautiful homes. I mean, homes that many people in the world, I mean, I know in Sugar Land, you can always find somebody with a much, much bigger house than you. But many people in the world would walk our streets and they would think we already lived in mansions like the one Jesus promised us. So it's easy for us to sometimes allow our longing for the next life to dip a little bit because sometimes we are so pleased in this life. But what Lewis is saying, that in moments where we are confronted with our own death, where not even the plenty we experience in this life can satisfy our soul, that that is a sign of God's grace, because it is God reminding us we are not home yet. He has more in store for us. How do we know that he cares for us in our brokenness? Well, in passages like this, we get a picture that God loves us so much that he invaded our brokenness, that he might be with us in our suffering, save us from our sins, and set us on a course towards new life. In verse 13, we were told that when Jesus saw her, that is the widow, the grieving mother, it says his heart went out to her, and he said, "Don't cry." It's a beautiful picture of the compassion of Jesus. Sometimes, like I've said before, because we're so familiar with Jesus, we don't always grasp how profound it is that the God of all creation left the security of heaven, where there is no suffering, and he entered our world of pain and hardship so that he could be really toe-to-toe with us in our heartache. And when he saw us in that state, the Bible says over and over again, he has compassion for us. This is a word we need, a word of grace from God in times of suffering, because when we suffer, it is true that often a shroud of darkness can come over us. That's what Isaiah calls it in Isaiah 25, a shroud of darkness, so that it makes us seem as if we have been abandoned. But the story of Jesus is this: God has not abandoned us, he has joined us in the darkness, that he is here with us and that his heart goes out to us. And he didn't have to do that, right? He could have just given us a Sunday school lesson on how all of our brokenness is a result of our sinfulness, that we are both guilty of and victims of the fact that sin is alive and at work in the world. He could have said that, and that would be what we deserve. But remember, grace is when we are given what we do not deserve. And though we do not deserve his compassion, God gives it anyway. God is with us in our suffering, and he is with us in our dying. How do we know? Because Jesus himself would go all the way to the grave. That everything that you and I will experience in the dying process, Jesus has experienced just the same. So that we can trust that every moment that we journey towards death is a journey that Jesus has already taken, and we can trust that he is there with us. One of the really gifts of grace in this season of my life is that I have been blessed to be there with people as they die, really throughout my career, and really in ways that are difficult to even begin to describe. There are moments where God's presence in the room of a dying saint is as tangible as anything you will ever experience in this worship service. I can remember one time a dear friend in San Angelo, it was really our staff missionary, he had come off the field from Bolivia to come back to San Angelo because his mom was ill, and we gathered in her room, and really she had been unable to communicate for several days. And as the doctors always tell us, we think people can still hear even after they can't communicate. And so we began to sing some of Patsy's favorite hymns. We began to pray over her and talk to her about God being with her. And in the sacredness of that moment, she slipped from this life to the life to come. And I just want to tell you, it was a holy moment. Because we trusted that even though we could not be aware of whether or not our communication was connecting to Patsy's soul, we trusted that Jesus was. That in ways that we can't begin to imagine or comprehend, his spirit was there with Patsy's spirit, carrying her safely home. And why could he do that? Because he had already walked that road. Now, I know I've also been in rooms where it wasn't peaceful like that, and that sometimes startles us, and we think, well, what does that mean? It just means we like life, friends. It does. I liken it to when we were little kids, right, or you had little kids. Some nights, your kids just went to sleep like little angels, didn't they? And other nights, they fought it like they were one of the demons, you know? I mean, they felt demon-possessed in the way that they would shout and scream and run because they did not want to go to sleep. But because you are a parent who loves them, guess what? No matter whether they went kicking or screaming or whether they fell asleep in your arms, what did you do? You made sure they made it to bed, safe and secure, so that they could wake up happy and ready to go in the morning. Friends, that is the picture of God's grace for the dying. Whether we resist it until our last breath, or whether we go patiently, I mean, whether we go peacefully, just submitting ourselves to Christ's arms, friends, if we have put our faith in Jesus, our Heavenly Father will make sure that we are laid to rest in His arms and rise in His glory. And we get a picture of that in this story. It's an imperfect picture, right? Because we know here that the story tells us not a story of resurrection. We sometimes mistakenly think that, but of resuscitation. Jesus, in verse 14, he goes over and he stops the procession and he says to the young man, I say to you, get up. We lose a little bit in the English here. In the Greek, it's young man, I say to you, be raised. It's passive because that's the way the Greek speaks, but it's really a word, the same word that really gets used for resurrection, rise up. And it says, the dead man sat up and began to talk, and God gave him back to his mother. It's an imperfect picture because we know this is a healing that's only temporary. Just like Lazarus, just like the other young person who was raised from the dead in Jesus' ministry, we understand and think and believe they had to die again, which doesn't seem like a great deal, does it, to have to die twice. But at least for this mother, it was great to have her son back. And in all of these miracles, which is really the case for all of Jesus' miracles, they point toward Jesus was going to bring and has now brought for all of us. For Jesus didn't just want to raise one or two boys whose mothers needed them. He wanted to overcome death itself so that he might one day say to each one of us, rise up, and we would stand up talking. I love that picture because of my family circle, my son, my only son, not my only child, but my only son, he is the talkative one in the family. And he's not here today, so you'll have to ask him next week. You should watch the sermon because I give him $5 if I mention him in the sermon. I pay him royalties for being in the sermon. But he's not here today, so he's got to, hey, this is a good way to see if he ever follows back up with this. But he's my talkative one. And he literally, sometimes he would fight it going to sleep, but he would talk all the way till he fell asleep. And other times, you know, he would fall asleep just, you know, a little more quietly. But he always woke up talking. We never had to wonder when John Curtis was awake. Because on the moment he was awake, words were coming out of his mouth. And I love it. It was a sign of life. As a little boy, if he was awake, he was talking to you. Because he loved life and he wanted to express what he was feeling and what he was experiencing. And when I read this passage, sometimes it loses it a little bit when we just see it on the page. But he woke up talking because he was alive and ready for the day. And it's a beautiful picture for us of what Jesus is going to do for us when he raises us from the grave. If you've been with us on Wednesday night, we've been talking about kind of some of our misconceptions of heaven. And this is the very short version of this. When you and I die, our spirit is immediately with Christ. We believe that because of Jesus' promise to the thief on the cross. You know, he said, please remember me. And Jesus said, today you will be with me in paradise. But we are also awaiting a day when we won't just be spiritually with Jesus in heaven, but when Jesus will come again and he will make a new heaven and a new earth. And the scriptures tell us what? That the dead in Christ will rise. We will be given new bodies, and we will be more alive than we have ever been. We will be filled with life. Many of you don't want to go to heaven because you've seen pictures of heaven on TV and it just looks boring because you think, I don't want to sit around and play a harp all day and I don't want to be a ghost. That doesn't sound good. I mean, I like steak. Are we going to get to have steak in heaven? All the pictures of heaven seem so boring, but those are TV pictures of heaven. The Bible's picture of heaven is this. You will be given a new body.
And it will be a body that is uncorrupted by sin, and you will be whole and well, and everything you have loved about this life, the food and the company and the beauty of this world, friends, it's only a taste of what we will know in heaven. In fact, one of my favorite pictures of heaven comes from Isaiah 25. And there, it's really the image that John draws on in the book of Revelation. That he's talking about the great day of the Lord, and that you know, we end our lives with funerals. But friends, we will begin our life in glory with a feast, a wedding feast. And he says, on this mountain, the Lord Almighty will prepare a feast of rich foods for all peoples, a banquet of aged wine, the best of meats. So friends, Texans, I think we might have steak there. He says, and on this mountain, he will destroy the shroud that enfolds all people, the sheet that covers all nations. He will swallow up death forever, and the sovereign Lord will wipe away the tears from all faces. He will remove his people's disgrace from all the earth. And in that day, we will say, surely this is our God. We trusted in him, and he saved us. This is the Lord. We trusted in him. Let us rejoice and be glad in his salvation. Friends, we've had moments of great celebration on this earth. Some of you Baylor fans were celebrating really yesterday. I don't know if we have any Kansas fans, but you probably were too. We've had celebrations at the weddings of our children and celebrations when we achieve something good. But all of those celebrations pale in comparison to the celebration that we shall have when Christ raises us from the dead. I mean, this boy sat up talking, because my guess is he just couldn't believe he was alive again. How much more so will we on the day Jesus raises us from the dead? One of my favorite pictures of this, and one of the things that I hold in my mind when I think about that day, comes from a dear friend of mine, also in San Angelo. Her name was Mary Jo. Mary Jo was a senior adult in our church. She'd come to live close to her children. She started coming to our church, but she had grown up Methodist. And because Mary Jo had grown up Methodist, she didn't always get the Baptist rules about things. And so she had gone with our church family on a mission trip down to the border of Mexico. This was several years ago, and they had done their work at the orphanage or whatever, and then they had gone to a restaurant that night for supper. And of course, the waiter came around, like waiters do, and said, "Was anybody like anything to drink?" And because this was a Baptist mission trip, all the little ladies who were on the mission trip said, "Well, I'll take an iced tea, and I'd like a Diet Coke." And they went round and around, and Mary Jo's kind of brow furrowed a little bit. She didn't quite get what was happening. She said, "Well, I don't know about these ladies, but I'm going to have a margarita." And they kind of, you know, gasped. They didn't know what to do with this. But Mary Jo, she was just one of those ladies. She lived her life, and she didn't really care if you liked the way she was living it. She was going to live it anyway. And so she just goes, "All right." And nobody else wants a drink? And they said, "No." And I go around. Well, finally, the waiter gets back around to the drinks. And, you know, there we got all the iced teas and the Diet Cokes and Mary Jo with her margarita. And she picks it up, and she looks around, and she says, "Well, here's to me." Now, you can imagine this story gets back to the pastor, and I'm supposed to do something about that. I said, "Well, Mary Jo's Mary Jo." Well, the thing I did about that was a few years later, we buried Mary Jo. That's what happens in church. You love each other. You care for each other. You become a part of each other's family. And then you gather around at each other's grave and remind each other that God's grace is for us. And as we put Mary Jo into the ground, I remembered that story. Because I liked this idea. Sometimes we forget that God made us. We think that humility means denying that we are valuable. But friends, we are valuable, not because of what we've done or who we are, but because God has stamped his image on us, because God has died for us that we might live with him. And I think, based on Isaiah, like right there may be in that great heavenly feast of Baptist section where we'll toast with grape juice, but in that great heavenly feast, right? When God raises us from the dead and we find ourselves alive, like this young man in our story today, that we will rise up, not just talking, but shouting. And my guess is the very first thing we will do is toast our risen King. Amen. We will toast our risen King because we would not be alive without him. But the second thing that I think we'll do, Honestly, it's because death is just such a part of this life, because it affects everything we experience, that we will finally, I think for the very first time ever, feel actually fully alive. And we will just not really be able to contain our joy, that we will just feel like we always knew we were supposed to feel but never felt. And we, on our second toast after toasting our King, will say, "Here's to me." Not because we're prideful, but because we're joyful that God's grace is enough to save even a sinner like me. Friends, the shadow of the shroud of death, it covers this life. And there's no other road to walk but the road towards it. And in those moments, we can protest and lament and cry out, "This should not be," and I think God joins us in those prayers. We can trust, no matter how much the darkness grows, we are not abandoned, that God is with us even in our dying. We can trust death doesn't get the last say, that someday, with joyful surprise and jubilation, we will awake in his kingdom, alive as we've ever been. Would you join me in a word of prayer? Lord, we thank you for the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that, Lord, without it, we would have no hope, that without it, we would, like Dylan Thomas, just think that the only thing we can do is either despair or rage or enrage against the dying of the light. But Lord, we are not those who protest without hope. That Lord, we protest dying, and we protest the heartache that comes with it, not because we have no hope, but Lord, because we know it will not get the last say. Because we know it's not your intention for your people. That, Lord, you have come to save us, and that you've already defeated death on the cross and at the empty tomb. And Lord, now we must simply wait and persevere, trusting that even though we die, if we have put our faith in you, yet shall we live. We don't deserve it, God, but you give this life because you are filled with grace and love. So Lord, give us hope, fill us with your courage to face each new day, Lord, not on our own power, but the power of the resurrection that now lives in us. We pray this in the name of Jesus, our risen Lord, amen.